Hello everyone, Seth Mayo here from the Lohmann Planetarium, and I'm back with you for another weekly update of our night sky. This is for the week of April 13th through April 19th. So if you're out looking at the sky this week, I'll show you what to expect. So as per tradition, I like to start during the daytime sky. You can see the sun blazing overhead that you can see here. And what we'll do is we'll just slide ourselves over to the western part of our sky, so we can see the western horizon, and that way we can watch the sun set. And this week the sun will be setting in the 7:50 time frame or so, so we'll speed up time. You'll see the time move really quickly here. So again, this week about the 7:50 time frame for sunset, you notice sunset is getting later and later each night. Here in the spring, as we're getting closer to summertime, our days are still getting longer and our nights are getting shorter. So that will happen until the summer solstice in mid to late June when that occurs. So we'll set the sun, and you'll notice that kind of light glow around the sun after sunset, right? The Earth's atmosphere refracts the light from the sun and allows the light from the sun to remain even when the sun's below the horizon. So that's why it usually takes a little while for it to get dark out after sunset. Usually 30 to 45 minutes after is pretty good time to wait. Even longer for a really dark sky. But even before that happens, you'll notice what looks like the star that appears. You've probably already noticed this in 2020. And that's this thing here. I've already talked about it quite a bit. And yes, it's still the planet Venus. The second planet from the sun is still there in the sky, and just can't have enough of Venus, right, this year. And it is really bright, hottest planet in the solar system, and it's going to look like a star that doesn't twinkle. So if you see this non-twinkling, really bright thing, that's the planet Venus shining still in the west, and it's gorgeous. So hopefully you'll see that. And then once it gets dark enough to see the stars, you'll find that Venus is still sitting among leftover wintertime stars and constellations in this area. So we'll get closer to like the 9 o'clock hour when it's pretty dark out by then. So right about here, that's about 8:45, close enough. And so by this time, so you still see Venus, and not far from Venus, you'll see three stars in a row. You might know that is the belt of Orion the Hunter. Here are his shoulders, his legs and feet. They're still visible in the sky. We'll make an outline of him because that's always fun. And then we'll draw or put up his picture as well. From Greek mythology, Orion the Hunter is one of the most famous constellations in our sky, so it's good to still be able to talk about him. And Orion's belt, as you may know, points you to the brightest star called Sirius. This star right here, and Sirius is part of the dog constellation known as Canis Major. Canis Major is one of the hunting dogs of Orion. So the brightest star, Sirius, and Orion, and the three stars of the belt, you can still see them above the western and southwestern horizon. You still have some time, but don't wait too long because they'll set before, if you stay up late. And so Venus will be nearby. Now, one star in particular I haven't really had a chance to discuss in these online night sky programs, and that's a star right here that kind of has this reddish-looking glow. And you may have seen it in the wintertime and early spring. This is called Aldebaran. I'll click on it so you can see it. Aldebaran, and here's the top left here, the name, is an Arabic name. Actually, most stars in the sky, turns out, have Arabic names, especially if they begin with A and L. And in Arabic, it means the follower, because it follows this little group of stars called the Pleiades star cluster, or the Seven Sisters. And I've talked about this a few times, especially last week, because Venus was sitting right over top of this group of stars last week and the week before, really, when that occurred. And so that was a nice conjunction. But anyway, Aldebaran follows us through the sky. And so if you speed up time here, you'll notice the stars as they shift through their what's called sidereal motion, you'll see that there's Pleiades moving towards the western horizon, and then Aldebaran following close behind. So there's the name. So these stars and objects have names for certain reasons. They usually relate to something next to them or something that happens in relation to them in the sky. So it's kind of cool to look them up and figure out why people named certain things. Aldebaran, the follower of Pleiades. And that star Aldebaran, if you really take a look at it in the sky, has kind of an orangish reddish glow. And that's because it's a red giant star bloating up. It's at the end of its life, and it has ran out of its primary fuel in its core, and now it's kind of fusing heavier elements, bloating up. It's about 44 times bigger than our sun, and will one day just expel its gas into space and become a what's called a planetary nebula. It'll leave behind a dead core called a white dwarf in its center, and so it will not explode. Most likely, it is not big enough. It doesn't have enough mass for an explosion, a supernova, as you will. So our sun will behave the same way. It will not explode. It just will bloat up in billions of years' time and push its gas into space and become a planetary nebula. So our sun and Aldebaran kind of share the same fate. This is about 65 light years away. So the light takes about 65 or 66 years to travel from that star to reach us here on Earth. And that seems like a ridiculous distance away, and it truly is for us. But for stars, it's relatively close. So you can kind of consider this a stellar neighbor to our sun and solar system, Aldebaran. So that's a good one to find. Now, if you find Aldebaran, you'll notice the stars near it kind of form this V shape with Aldebaran. This is a cluster called Hyades, and Hyades cluster, along with Pleiades, are part of a constellation called Taurus the Bull. So if I turn on the constellation here, you'll see Orion kind of pop up. That's okay. And Aldebaran is supposed to be the eye of the bull. So this is the nose and head of the bull. Here are the horns, the tips of the horns. Pleiades is along the back. And I should be able to put the picture up of Taurus. Also a leftover winter constellation, also from Greek mythology, like Orion the Hunter. It almost looks like they're battling it out in the sky. But anyway, Aldebaran is right at the eye of Taurus. So I mention him now because it is getting kind of low, but also because Venus is not far away. And so if you want to find it, find Venus and then maybe find Aldebaran to the left or to the south of Venus. So that's kind of cool to see that star. Now, real quickly, I won't spend much time on this next thing here because I want to do a separate video about it. But let's slide ourselves over to the north, really northwestern part of the sky. And you may have heard about a comet sighting coming up. There is a comet, newly discovered comet called Comet Atlas. It was discovered in late December of last year, so pretty recent. And this comet, which is really this icy, rocky thing that was far away from us, now getting closer to the sun, will eventually, and it already is, lighting up. That's what comets do. They're these dark things. As they get close to the sun, their ices sublimate or vaporize into space and create this sort of gaseous envelope around the nucleus of the comet. That gaseous envelope can be stretched out by the solar wind and create a tail. And that's where you get a comet that's visible in our sky. And so this comet, Comet Atlas, is in this area of the sky, roughly speaking. To give you just an idea of what area we're looking at, this is the north. So here's the Big Dipper, here's the Handle, here's the Bowl. Very familiar shape, right? These two stars at the end of the bowl point you to the North Star right there. There's the North, also called Polaris. And the North Star is part of the Handle of the Little Dipper. There's the Handle, there's the Bowl. So this comet is in this area. You can't see it with the naked eye. You need a telescope to see it. May become visible to the naked eye this month, later this month, or most likely in May when it gets closer and closer to the sun. I can actually just show you real quickly the comet. We can search for it in Stellarium, which is pretty neat. So I can put the letter C for comet, slash, and then the year that it was discovered in, which was 2019. And hey, there it is. Comet 2019 Y4, or Atlas, named after a telescope in Hawaii that discovered it. Anyway, let's point towards it, and there it is. So we cannot see with our naked eyes, but possibly later on in May we might see it. But it may break apart. It may have already done so a little bit. It brightened up quite a bit after it was discovered, and then kind of slowed its brightness a bit. So we'll see what happens. Comets are notoriously unpredictable. We just don't know what's going to happen with them. And that's the fun part about it, is just to wait and see the evolution of the comet. So stay tuned. I'll have another video talking more about it and getting into the details of where it is and where it will be located. But it's going to be slowly moving to the northwestern horizon as we get to the rest of this month and into May. So as it moves through this area, this is in a constellation called Camelopardalis, a couple ways to say it. It's the giraffe constellation. Here it is. Believe it or not, that's a giraffe, which is pretty tough. And I'll put up the artwork too. So it's sitting in the boundary of the giraffe. Here's the boundary of it. You can actually make boundaries of constellations. And this boundary area is actually where it sits inside the giraffe constellation right now. So there you go. Comet Atlas, possibly visible in our sky later on. But we'll see. We just got to stay tuned for it. There's a name too of the constellation there. Anyway, so that's in the northwest. Now let's just slide ourselves over to a couple more areas of the sky. There's the west where we saw Orion and Venus, some leftover winter stars. But we'll zoom out actually and look at the zenith, just straight up in the sky. And if we get a chance to do that, we'll really start seeing spring stars. So really high up, you'll find the stars I'm circling now, and you'll notice a group of stars that look like a hook or a backwards question mark, and that is the constellation, or at least the head of the constellation Leo, the lion. So here's the head, the body, and tail of Leo. And by the way, Hercules fought Leo in many of the stories from Greek mythology. Leo usually wasn't too nice of a creature. And I will draw or put up his picture of Leo there. So prominent springtime constellation. And along with Leo, we have this slithering constellation that's Hydra, the largest by area constellation in the sky. Hydra is pretty well known. And we're now in the southeast. Near the tail, we have this sort of interesting shape. This is called Corvus the Crow that sits in this part of the sky. And not far from that, you'll see a star called Spica. And that star is part of the well-known zodiac sign called Virgo the Maiden, also part of the spring set of stars here. And also in this area, we'll go a little further north here. We kind of made a big circle around the sky already, but there's Spica. It's a binary star system, actually two stars orbiting around each other. We move a little bit more north, we get to the brightest spring star, the fourth brightest star in the sky. This is Arcturus right here, which is called, which is part of Boötes the Herdsman. And so these are all spring stars rising out of the east, all kind of headed by Leo the Lion. When I see Leo, I always know spring is getting close as he kind of enters the scene. And so he is now dominating the sky really high up after sunset and through most of the evening. So that's kind of nice. All right, now one more area of the sky we'll mention, and that's the early morning. So for those early morning risers, definitely pay attention here. If you're not an early morning riser, I would definitely consider getting up because there's an extraordinary amount of objects visible in the morning right now before sunrise. So we're going to move through 10, 11, 12 o'clock at night here. And this will kind of count for this whole week for the morning, but in particular, earlier in the week, you'll see that the moon will be nearby these objects I'm about to talk about. So here's the moon at the beginning of this week here. And so we'll stop in the 5 o'clock hour. I know that's really early, but there's a chance you might be up, right? So just before six, there you go. So this is at 5:50 in the morning. So definitely wake up, wake your whole family up. And if you look in the kind of east, southeastern part of the sky, more towards the ocean, if you're here in Daytona, if you're not, just towards the east, and you'll see the moon on the morning of, this is Tuesday morning, the 14th, it'll be a half moon, which is, I think that's last quarter phase there, and then followed by these three bright things, and they're not going to twinkle like the stars because they're planets. I mentioned them last week and the week before, but we have three planets really close, and in the morning of the 14th, that's the Tuesday morning, they're all lined up with the moon. That's a really cool, I guess you could say, conjunction going on there. And if you're a photographer, it's a cool opportunity to take pictures of these objects within our solar system. So you may wonder what planets these are. This reddish-looking one should give it away. That's the planet Mars right here. Hey, we're right. There's Mars, fourth planet from the sun. And then after Mars, over here, more towards kind of this, a little higher up in the sky, this is Saturn, the beautiful ringed planet, much farther away from us than Mars is, but they look close in the sky. And so we have beautiful planet Saturn, a gas giant, and then the biggest planet in the solar system, the king of planets, even brighter than these two should be, is the planet Jupiter, the fifth planet from our sun in the solar system. So Jupiter, Saturn, Mars, and the moon at the beginning of the week. Now we can speed up time and go to the next couple mornings here. So this is Tuesday morning. Wednesday morning, the moon will be right underneath Saturn there. And so that's pretty cool. So that's Wednesday morning. Thursday morning, it will be near near Mars, the crescent moon now. That's Thursday. Then Friday morning, the 17th, even more of a crescent moon. The moon's a little farther away, but still not too far. And then by Saturday and Sunday, the moon will move more towards the sun in the east there, and they'll be a bit farther away, but you'll still have Mars, Saturn, and Jupiter still relatively close to each other in the early morning sky. So definitely take advantage of these planetary lineups going on. It's really great right now. And we will kind of speed time up here to get the sun to rise in the morning for this week. And that begins another new day. There you go. So that concludes this weekly session of our sky tonight. Hope inspires you to get out and look at the sky, not just in the evening, but maybe in the morning, all those great things. And again, we'll talk more about Comet Atlas as well coming up in another separate video. But thanks for tuning in, and check us out again through our social media pages on our website for more content like this, more weekly updates of the night sky. Thanks for tuning in. Thanks for checking us out. Happy stargazing, and we'll see you again. Take care.